Welcome back to our module Sustainable Biopolymers. Today's lecture is about feedstock and application of biopolymers. That we think about from which resources we want to produce our polymers, what kind of applications they have, and some of their properties. Just as a reminder, we defined two different possibilities, biodegradability and bio-based, renewable resource-based production. And we have polymers which are fossil-based, so from crude oil, but still are biodegradable on the left-hand corner. And we have bio-based, so from renewable resource-based polymers, which are not easily biodegraded. And obviously we have then on the right-hand, upper-hand corner, polymers, biodegradable and bio-based. And one of the examples that give the advantage of a biodegradable polymer is the Malchfol in agriculture, where you can grow your plant in the hollows of the foil, thereby having a more rapid growth. You don't have contamination, you don't have other weeds coming up, and that's one of the reasons why these foils are more and more increasingly used in agriculture, especially in Europe, but worldwide. The gain is quite substantially. Usually PE, crude oil-based, non-biodegradable foils are used. And this is one example of a waste site of these foils. Obviously, you can also incinerate them, which is a far better solution. However, if we would have a foil that's biodegradable, then we can leave it on the agricultural field and then it degrades there. And these products are actually available. EcoVio from BASF is one of these examples, where a polylactate is mixed with a fossil-based biodegradable polymer, which is called EcoFlex. It's a brand name. This foil is rapidly degraded in an agricultural setting. After 4 weeks, the foil, in ideal case, is gone. Excitingly, there are all different kinds of applications, including the malfilms, but also it's allowed to have food contact. So for packaging material, it's also possible. And BASF managed to get the approval of a lot of different countries for these applications. When we think about the possibilities of recycling and waste management, we have to think about composting, and especially in industrial composting plants. And that's what also the product from BASF most likely will undergo. And there we have, first of all, the composting to CO2 and water. But in industrial composting, it's really quick because we have a bioactive environment, a good to high moisture content, and a very high temperature. And this helps to reduce the time of composting to 40 to 70 days. When you compare it with a classic compost, maybe in your garden, there it would, a biodegradable polymer may would use 180 days for 90% of the degradation. Yes, we can think about the different possibilities how to deal with the waste, but then very quickly in the collection, we will mix plastic species. That's what we already do with our packaging. But think about this example. We have a PET bottle. If we would recycle it, we get PET flakes and we can produce valuable PET bottles again out of it. So there's a closed loop recycling possible. Now there are a lot of arguments out there that it's not a good idea to use biodegradable polymers because then they mix and we get lower quality flakes and then maybe lower quality applications. From Dresden, a group investigated this contamination of polystyrene and other plastics by polylactic acid. So PLA, a renewable resource-based plastic. If this is possible to mix it into the flakes and get the same properties. And indeed, with polystyrene, the weight percentage was up to 10% without losing quality. In other examples, it was as low as 3%. But still, thinking about the market size of some of these polymers, even 3% can be attractive for bio and renewable-based biopolymers. These biopolymers have to be synthesized from renewable resources, and we usually discuss about first generation. First generation biopolymers are synthesized from corn or from wheat and the kernels, so from starch, from glucose, finally. And this is clearly competing with our feed and food production. So we could feed our animals, or we could break bread instead, producing plastics. In the second generation, far more attractive for industry is that we use non-food crops and waste materials. And the example is simple. Instead of using the corn kernel, we use the corn wheat or the wheat straw as a carbon source to feed and produce our biopolymers. In the third generation, it's envisaged that we don't even compete with land use, but that we use feedstocks with no need of agricultural acreage. And one example are waste streams again, and that we use algae, which fix the carbon dioxide and can be grown in an aqueous system. Now we have the substrate on the left-hand side, wood plant material, ideally non-food competition. And then we have the possibility of producing different polymers. And there are three different synthesis routes. One is the modification of natural biopolymers. And we do that for a long time, for centuries. Think about how a sheep looks, think about how a cotton plant looks, and think about the clothes you're wearing. There are a lot of modification steps that you have a nice textile. And the biopolymer is changed during this. We can produce monomers from renewable resources, and these monomers are then chemically synthesized to the polymer. And the example is polybutylene and others. Or we use the synthesis capacity of microbes directly. So we feed the microbe, produce plastics, and here's an example of some Pseudomonas butida producing PHA. And these granules you see there, this is bioplastics, this is PHA, polyhydroxyalkanoates, a polyester, which is bio-based and biodegradable. And now bringing it again into the context of the biodegradation and bio-based, we have these three different synthesis routes, and we can group them. And the ones which are biodegradable, bio-based, they can be synthesized by chemical synthesis or direct biosynthesis, while the ones which are from fossil-based can only be synthesized via chemical routes. When we think about these biopolymers, we have to think about their properties. They should be non-toxic, biocompatible, high strength, and others. We can make it more simple. Polymers should be hard and stiff, soft and flexible, or a viscous liquid. This can be our glues, for example. And then we have to look on the molecular structure. And the molecular structure depends on the polymer used. We have plastics which can be melted, and the same product is formed. PET bottles is the best example. So you melt the PET, and then you blow again a bottle. These are thermoplasts. The bonds are only in the polymer chain. When you think about your PU foam, your mattress, or your car seat, there you have a very flexible foam, if you heat this up, it only degrades. You don't get a liquid plastic where you can produce again PU, because it's molecularly changed the monomers to the polymer, and there are extra covalent bonds formed between the polymer chains. So they have to be treated differently, also recycled different, because you can't do a heat recycling. But you can get it hard and stiff, soft and flexible, while thermoplasts are viscous and liquid. For the application, we also have to think about two further parameters, and especially correlated with temperature. These are intrinsic to the polymer-polymer mixture, maybe also the molecular weight. And this is the glass transition temperature, maybe not so familiar to you, and the melting temperature, very familiar to you. So if you take a heat source, you bring plastic in there, depending on the plastic, it melts and your product is destroyed, or at least partially destroyed. This is important for production, how the manufacturer can melt the resin to produce, for example, a cup of coffee. But the use is also important, the glass transition temperature, because it determines how brittle or, on the other case, how flexible rubbery a product is. And here are two examples. If we use hard plastic on the left-hand side, like polystyrene, the use is below the glass transition temperature. So it's in a glassy state. It's sturdy. If you think about the polyisoprene here used, it should be soft and rubbery-like, an elastomer, very flexible. Then it's above the glass transition, so there is no sturdiness of the polymer. Now we have the substrate to get to the polymer. We have some properties of the biopolymers or the polymers. Now we have to think about the polymer market and the possibilities of biopolymers to contribute. And packaging is the market. 40% of the almost 50 million tons in Europe of plastic, of polymers used, are for packaging. And there also a lot of chance for biopolymers is. I told you other examples in agriculture. It's a small market, but it's growing because we have to intensify our agricultural system because we want to feed more people on this earth. But think about building and construction. Pipes, usually they were out of metal. Nowadays, for quite some time actually, they are now out of different polymers. And we have other examples for the increase. Use of biopolymers. Out of the 330 plus million tons of global plastic production in 2016, less than 1% are biopolymers. And if you think again about this different application, you have to think about packaging, because there the possibility is actually exciting and growing. There are drop-in polymers, we discussed it later, bio-PET, bio-PE, or really from renewable resources produced novel polymers like polylactic acid. Sometimes we actually want in the application the property of biodegradability. And this is not very good for the milk bottle. There it should not be biodegradable or it's solubilized. But in some medical applications, you would like to bring in materials that close a wound, that stabilize something. But after a while, you would like the body is functioned naturally, and then that it's the piece of plastic is degraded. Or in spine applications, that there is a plastic a slip disc repaired, or that there are other parts of the spine repaired by plastic parts. And this is feasible today. I mentioned it already, packaging is dominating the biopolymer sector. We see here, if we packaging the rigid packaging, it's dominated by bio-PET, bio-PE, while flexible packaging, There is polylactic acid and starch blends used. And these are our foils, for example. Agriculture, I was already pointing out. I have to mention textiles, because the market is usually increasing in the near future, and we have to think about how we get more biopolymers into this market. You think about, naturally, we have the biopolymers. Yes, that's true. There is a little bit of wool. There's a good portion of cotton. And there's some growth of cellulosic fibers from wood and other materials. But it's absolutely dominating, the growth at least, dominating by polyester fibers. And there we have to think about how do we get contribution of biopolyester into this fraction, because otherwise the crude oil based production is really dominating also this market, and the size with 100 million tons already is really considerable. So in total we have to think about renewable resource based production routes, we have to think about application, we have to think about the properties of the maybe also new materials, and then we have to research how this all goes hand in hand, that we can make an impact in these values change and this very highly dynamic value change developments. Thank you.